It's time for another episode of Let's Talk Business, featuring interviews with South Carolina business executives, community leaders, and government dignitaries. Let's Talk Business is a truly one-of-a-kind business-to-business talk show. And now, here's your host, longtime South Carolina business publisher, Rick Jenkins.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to Let's Talk Business, episode number 9. I am your host, Rick Jenkins, and I am so glad that you've joined us, whether you are catching our radio show on 94.5 The Answer in the Upstate, or maybe you have downloaded our podcast on Spotify or Google or Apple, or maybe you're just watching our weekly YouTube video series. Regardless of how you're accessing us, I'm so glad you did. Thanks for joining. We got a good show for you today. We've got three folks that are going to be coming on board. One of them is Vicki Peek. Vicki is the Executive Vice President and Consulting Division Leader at FGP, or Find Great People, and I think most of you know, but FGP is a staffing search and consulting firm headquartered in Greenville. They do have offices in Charleston and Columbia and even in Nashville, Tennessee, but they are headquartered right here in Greenville. Vicki has been in her job for 31 years, lots of experience, and I'm going to enjoy talking to her for a few minutes. Miranda Craig. Miranda is a Business Development Associate with SCMEP, the South Carolina Manufacturing Extension Partnership. Now, if you don't know SCMEP, they are a nonprofit organization, and their job basically is to help South Carolina manufacturers in any way those manufacturers need assistance. And they can do that in a lot of different ways. They are funded on a national level. They are funded on a state level. And we will talk to Miranda about a variety of issues as it relates to supply chain. Lieutenant Governor Pamela Evatt is joining us again. The Lieutenant Governor comes on the show with us quarterly to talk about a variety of business topics. Now, one of the reasons that I always enjoy it when the Lieutenant Governor joins us is that before she was Lieutenant Governor Evatt, she was Pam. And as Pam, she was a business owner. Her and her husband, David, they started their own business called Quality Business Solutions a couple decades ago. They did it from their kitchen table. They came up with the idea, and it turned into something huge. And now that business they do business globally, really. And I always like it when Lieutenant Governor joins us because she has a unique perspective on business. She was a business person herself for many, many years. She was a proven and successful business entrepreneur. So she has a good view of the business world and the business community in South Carolina. And so I always like to get her feedback. Folks, that is who is going to join us on the show today, and we're going to be right back to talk to those folks here in a minute. But before we do, we're going to get a quick tip. It's time for a 60-second piece of advice from our wealth management expert, Jeff Froman. Jeff is a certified financial planner and financial advisor at Ameriprise Financial Services. Let's hear what Jeff has to say, and we will be right back.
Let's talk about the three most basic investment vehicles there are, the mutual fund, the ETF, and the stocks, and their pros and cons. Starting with the mutual fund, active management. You have somebody that is designing the portfolio to try to get you the best return and changes as the market changes. Generally lower risk than an individual stock. And the cons is that it's less tax efficient because if there are capital gains in the fund, they're distributed every year and you pay the taxes. With the ETF, they're lower risk than individual stocks as well because you're invested in a lot of things. They tend to be more tax efficient because you don't pay capital gains until you sell it. The cons are passive management designed around an index. So it doesn't change as the market changes. The index stays the same. With individual stocks, you have the highest possible return, meaning if you pick the right stock, you can make a lot of money. They are also tax efficient for the same reason you don't pay capital gains until you sell. And the cons, the greatest risk. You pick the wrong stock, it can go to zero and you can lose it all. So decide how you want to be invested. Talk to your financial advisor or reach out to me, Jeff Froman, Ameriprise. Back to you, Rick.
Hello, everyone, and welcome back to Let's Talk Business. I am glad that you joined us. I am here with our first guest today, and that is Vicki Peek. Vicki is the Executive Vice President for Find Great People, or FGP, and she is also the Consulting Division Leader. Vicki, welcome.
Thank you.
It's good to have you here. Tell me what Consulting Division Leader means.
Well, we have always found talent, so that is our core of our business, where we started. And over the years, determined our clients really have a need to once they find the talent, to actually onboard, develop, retain, and sometimes have to transition. And so we came in with the consulting side to say, how can we actually provide this additional service for our clients?
And how long has that been there?
That has been there since 2007.
Okay. And speaking of being there for a little while, I believe you have been at FGP from since before 2007. You have been there for 31 years.
Yes. Yes.
Right?
My entire career has been in the talent space.
Right. And has your entire career been at FGP itself?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
All right. You must like it a little bit.
I love people.
Yeah, right. And finding great people.
Yes.
Okay, let's talk about HR trends. Tell me, you know, and let's take a step back for a second. A couple years ago, we had this thing called COVID hit, right? And COVID just kind of threw your all's industry into a crazy spin, right? And so I think that what the staffing industry has seen is a whole lot of this over these last few years, trying to settle into whatever this new world is going to be, right? Are we remote? Are we hybrid? Are we going to be more remote? Are we going to be all these things, correct? Mm-hmm. Tell me what we're looking at now. What does it feel like out there right now?
Yeah, so it's not a one size fits all. And I think that's the biggest thing. I think people try to kind of find what is that right answer. Mm-hmm. And I believe we have to know our people, we have to know our industry, we have to know what the competitive space is, both to attract and retain talent. But we have seen organizations actually have to broaden their scope and not be so focused on what are we paying people or what are we providing for people, but really moving out more into meaning and purpose, engagement and inclusion, growth and development, and yes, comp and benefits. So almost pulling multiple aspects into their decision-making as they lead their organizations.
Is retaining folks more difficult today than it was not too long ago?
It certainly has gone up and down. I think we're seeing a little bit of a stabilization of people moving. People are trying to get a little more tenure in their space. But certainly we have to work harder as organizations to ensure that we are engaging our workforce so that we can retain that high-performing talent.
It seems like there for a while, employees were just hard to please. They wanted what they wanted, and they were going to get it no matter what. It's there for a while, it seemed that the employee had all the leverage in that relationship. And I believe that has circled back now, yes?
Yes, and they had a lot of, they could have a lot of demands, you know, compensation or additional benefits.
Right.
And that's where I think I've seen more and more organizations come back to what is at our core? What is our culture? What are our values? And really coming back to the foundation of who we are and telling that story versus trying to go after talent with different perks or different things, but more. What is the heart of who we are? Who do we serve? And what is the type of workforce that we want?
You still have to keep people, though. So you have to pay a fair wage, of course. Yes. And you do have to have perks that are at least competitive. What are those types of things? What are those types of perks that people are looking for today? Is it just remote work? Is it I want to be hybrid? I want to be able to work from home? Of course, that's one of them. Mm-hmm. But what are some of the others?
Yeah, so of course we want to be competitive with our pay. So I think a comp analysis every couple of years just to ensure that we're within market. Going further than that, you know, what are those extra benefits? We're seeing a lot around mental health. So what are we providing from a wellness standpoint? And providing additional counseling or EAP or different resources, mental health days. So that piece we've seen actually an increase that organizations are implementing. And then paid time off. So people appreciate time. And so really evaluating PTO policies to where people maintain that work-life balance. And then the last thing I would say is flexibility. So what is my schedule? And can I have a little bit of autonomy, if I'm a high performer especially, with being a little more flexible?
You know, something came up a few years ago that just surprised me to no end. And that was that companies began offering unlimited PTO. And the company that I was working for at the time offered unlimited PTO. And I thought, oh my gosh, what the heck is the world coming to? Now, it really didn't mean that people could just, you know, it didn't mean what you might initially think it means, but it's a thing. It's a thing now, right?
It is, but I think it's industry specific. I think sometimes it's positioned specific. So it certainly is not going to be for every organization. But I think to your point, whether it's unlimited or we actually have certain days, I think the key here is make sure, again, we know our people and we've asked for what they really care about. And then we've evaluated, you know, to where those policies are fresh and we're staying current.
How has compensation changed over the last few years? I would assume that as companies were trying to remain competitive through the COVID periods of time and then the great resignation, so to speak, that occurred, that compensation might have gotten a little bit out of whack. I would assume that then companies have to deal with that for quite some time until you have turnover again. What's that look like these days?
Yeah, and you can get really out of balance with that particular area. Now we're seeing organizations really evaluate budget. So where can they cut costs? And so one thing that we've recommended to clients is identify your high impact roles and really put your resources into those roles, whether that's internal talent, moving that to those roles, moving talent to those roles and paying maybe additional compensation, or using those resources to attract the talent that you need.
So, Vicki, I'll get you out of here on these next couple of questions. Let's talk about leaders within the workplace. What can leaders do? I mean, you know, everybody's got a CEO, but we're not just talking CEOs. We're talking about leaders within certain departments. It's got to fall to them a little bit to make sure that people are happy, to make sure that the company is doing kind of, I guess, working that fine line between of making sure that the employees are getting what they want and making sure the employer is getting what he wants. What does that look like to you?
Yeah, so at the beginning, I mentioned values and culture. It's set at the top. An organization has a culture. But I actually think one of the most critical roles is each of the leaders in the organization. They almost have the ability to create a subset culture. And that's either really good or that's really bad. And so the leader is critical in, they're closest to the employees. And so it's important for them to be relational, to build trust, to be present, especially with the virtual environment. Are we connecting? To really create accountability throughout their team, to create a platform for the team to collaborate so that they do feel a part of a team. And then the last thing I think sometimes we miss, and that is express gratitude, lead with gratitude, and really sharing different things that they're grateful for their team, for things that they're accomplishing, for their customers, but just leading with gratitude.
I can't think of a better way to end the conversation than leading with gratitude. Vicki, thanks so much for joining
us. Thank you.
You are welcome, folks. That is Vicki Peek, and she is with FGP, or Find Great People. Don't go anywhere. We'll be back in only 60 seconds, and we'll see you in just a minute. Thanks.
I bet you want a website that drums up business. You see, every business wants to have an effective online presence that helps their business grow.
At Drum Creative,
we guide you through our process that will drive results by clarifying your message with a beautiful design that's strategically optimized for search.
Visit our website at drumcreative.com
and let us help you drum up business by designing a website that speaks to your audience and delivers results.
Hello, everyone, and welcome back to Let's Talk Business. I am glad that you are here. Whether you are joining us and listening in on the radio, 94.5 The Answer here in the Upstate, catching our podcast, or maybe just watching the weekly YouTube video series, I'm glad you found us. Up next, I'm going to be talking to Miranda Craig. Miranda has joined us, and she is from SCMEP. That is the South Carolina Manufacturing Extension Partnership. A lot of you know this, but in case you don't, SCMEP is a nonprofit organization that serves South Carolina manufacturers, providing them with a range of innovative strategies and solutions to improve competitiveness, performance, and profitability. They are funded both on a national level and at the state level. And what I usually like to say about SCMEP is if you are a manufacturer in South Carolina and you need assistance, you call the good folks at SCMEP because it's their job basically to assist a manufacturer in any way they need assistance. And now I am joined by Miranda Craig. Miranda, welcome.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
It is good to have you here. We just met shortly before we came on the air, and I know most everyone at SCMEP, but you are fairly new. You've only been there 4 months, right?
That's correct. Yeah, I joined the team in April of this year.
So tell us what led you from, let's see, Tennessee, you told me.
That's right.
even though you did go to school, you got your, what, master's at South Carolina?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so you have been here for a little while, but what led you from Tennessee to South Carolina and then into Greenville to work at SCME?
Yeah, so I'm born and raised in the hills of East Tennessee, so I'm very Appalachian. That's okay. My heritage for sure. And my husband and I got married in 2012, and we moved to the Myrtle Beach area for him to pursue his master's degree at Coastal Carolina University. So go Teal Pride. So he went there, and I actually took a job with the South Carolina Vocational Rehabilitation Department driving a forklift.
Oh, my goodness.
So I worked in that production facility and worked with individuals with disabilities to help them learn job skills so that they could go to work, largely in the manufacturing sector. I stayed with vocational rehabilitation for about 10 years. When I left the agency in April to come to MEP, I was working as the director of job readiness training at their headquarters in Columbia. And a large part of my job was working with our training centers that are all throughout the state to partner with the manufacturing community to help people with individuals with disabilities to gain the work skills and go to work in those settings. So I always kind of had one foot in manufacturing and one foot in human services. So I was very drawn to manufacturing, and especially after COVID, that was really when my interest peaked, and SCMEP had an opportunity to work specifically with their center on supply chain strategies and address some of the supply chain challenges felt by manufacturers here in South Carolina. So that's where I came on board.
It's good to have you in the state. I tell you, we're going to get all into supply chain stuff here in a second. Mm-hmm. But if you are going to be in manufacturing, South Carolina is a great place to be.
That's the truth.
We know a thing or two about manufacturing in this state. And if you're going to be in manufacturing, then you could not work at a better place than SCMEP. And let's stick there for a second. For the folks who don't know that are tuning in right now, tell us about SCMEP. What is the mission of that organization, and how do you fill in?
Yeah, so the mission of SCMEP really is to help manufacturers be competitive and profitable, and to make sure that we're providing the best and greatest tools and resources that we can, either through our team internally or through our network of over 150 service providers throughout the state to meet the needs of manufacturers. And one thing that really attracted me to SCMEP is the fact that they stay so cutting edge and so current. So they're a very proactive organization. And even all the work we're doing now with supply chain is very cutting edge. We want to make sure we're bringing South Carolina the latest and greatest that they need to ensure their success.
Let's talk about supply chain. A few years ago, there was this thing called COVID that hit, right?
Oh, yeah.
And I think that for the most part, people had not heard the term. Well, folks in the industry had, of course. But many folks had not even heard supply chain, right? But it became a real part of all of our lexicon really quick. I'm sure you went out and bought a ton of toilet paper, right? And we all understood that because we were freaking out about toilet paper, that there was a problem with something called the supply chain. But supply chain has been around a long time. And so now we are past COVID, but we still have supply chain issues from time to time. Tell me, Miranda, what do you do at SCMEP in terms of how that relates to supply chain?
Yeah, so you're exactly right. I don't think anybody paid supply chain a second thought until COVID. And then we really began to understand as a society and a culture what a volatile industry this is,
sure,
and how fragile and how important it is. It's critical to every facet of our economy, and particularly here in South Carolina. You know, we are a logistics powerhouse, we're a manufacturing powerhouse, and for us, supply chain is at the heart of everything that we do. So at SCMEP, we've received federal funding and state funding through the South Carolina Department of Commerce to launch what we're calling our Manufacturer Supply Chain Connectivity Program. And my role at the organization is really just to administer the program and to do everything I can through our power in our center, so at SCMEP, as well as our extended national network with every other MEP center in the United States, to make sure we're addressing the supply chain challenges felt by manufacturers.
Okay, so NIST, of course, is a national nonprofit organization. And as I understand it, they gave you all some funding in terms of a grant and said, go out and what did they tell you to do? They gave it to all the MEPs, right?
Correct.
There's 51 MEPs.
51, every state and Puerto Rico. Yep.
Exactly. So what did they tell you all to do? And was it the same thing that everyone else is doing?
Yeah.
Or are you going in your own separate ways?
Everyone's kind of doing their own thing because every state's a little bit different. So every MEP center has their own flavor and their own mix of manufacturing industries with whom they work. So for us, we are kind of tackling four specific areas with our program and the grant money that we received. The first one is education and awareness campaign around supply chain best practices. So we'll be rolling out a lot of events to do with sustainability in the supply chain, reshoring, total cost of ownership, all these topics that are very pertinent to the industry. And we'll be bringing in a lot of subject matter experts to help us have those conversations. And we're also going to be launching some supply chain maps of different industries throughout the state. So we're working with a third party right now to map the aerospace, automotive, and Department of Defense supply chains throughout South Carolina.
And so the funding that NIST has committed, mm-hmm. when did that commitment occur, first of all?
Yeah, I believe it went into effect in July, July 1st.
Okay. Yeah. So is your job a new one at SCMEP?
So we've had the role of the business development associate before.
Right.
And that role is largely to support our regional vice presidents and their initiatives. And with this, you know, we kind of took a different approach that the business development associate would be primarily administering the supply chain connectivity program.
Got it. And so is the job that you're filling now, is it tied to these dollars that are coming from NIST in some way that, you know, that you are saying, hey, let's take these dollars and enact them in some way? Are these tied together in some fashion?
Yeah, so I would say that the funding that we have is going to the programs that my position would support is probably the best way to think about it.
Makes sense. So what does it mean to have a resilient supply chain?
Good question. And that's really the most important question that a lot of manufacturers are asking right now. There's a lot of different ways to look at resiliency in your supply chain. But I think at the end of the day, it really boils down to two areas: your relations with the people in your supply chains and the locations that they're located. And when we kind of examine the relationships that we have with every unit in the supply chain, which, as you know, can be enormous in the world of manufacturing, we want to make sure we're relying on people that we know are going to be there, that are going to give us reliable lead times, that we're meeting our customer demands and all of these things. There's so much that goes into it. Total cost of ownership and making sure we're being wise with these make versus buy decisions. So who are we doing business with is really the first question we have to ask. And the second question is, where are they located? Because, of course, there's so many things outside of control, right, when we're working with the supply chain. And the further out we get geographically, there's a lot more things that could go wrong. If I'm doing business with someone in, say, California or even in another country, that's kind of riskier than if I were doing business with someone right here in South Carolina in my own backyard. So one of the things that we are hoping to do with our connectivity program is connecting these manufacturers, making sure they know who are the players, so who are those people we can have relationships with, and where are they located? Can we find someone here in South Carolina to meet the need of that business and keeping that business here in our state as opposed to taking it, you know, three states over or even to another country?
Yeah. And, you know, I would think, and you correct me if I'm wrong, but I would think supply chain issues, that we might be more aware of supply chain issues in South Carolina than others, if for no other reason than you've got the Port of Charleston.
Yep.
You've got the inland port that is just up the road here in Greer, right?
Yep.
You've got these things that other states may not necessarily experience.
Exactly.
And I would assume that is impactful, potentially more impactful than other places.
Yeah, very much so. We're really in a good spot to support our manufacturers with, again, the infrastructure that we have. And, you know, the port of Charleston is the deepest on the East Coast now. And we're seeing that influx. We're seeing that business come here. We want to do everything we can to keep it here and to keep jobs here. Another great thing that we're doing is we've just launched the Connect South Carolina Marketplace platform. And this is our brand new state-of-the-art supply chain solutions platform that we administer at SCMEP. The platform's been completely funded by the South Carolina Department of Commerce. And the whole goal of the platform is to, again, connect manufacturers here in our state and make sure we know who the players are and we know where they're located so we can have more of these things that could go wrong go right. We want to make sure we've got the answers in our back pocket.
It's called Connects.
That's right. Yep. Connects SC.
Tell me what that is exactly. Are we looking at, is this a website?
Yes, sir.
Yeah,
so, it's a cloud-based service as a software platform, and it was developed by a software company based actually out of Utah, but they put this thing together and they worked with the MEP centers to build it. So all of the input from the very onset of the platform has been from the manufacturers and people working in the industry. So the way that the platform works is it's essentially a database, but it's administered by the state MEP centers. So I personally vet every single manufacturer that comes onto the site. We make sure that they're a legitimate manufacturer. We make sure they need to be there. And then it's a matter of making sure they can find what they need in the platform. They're able to respond to business opportunities, to post out RFIs, RFQs. They're able to search against SBA designated programs within their industries. They're able to look for certifications that the suppliers may have that they require, products, services, you name it, it's there. And the whole goal is the more people we can get onto the platform, which again has already been paid for, so it's free. The more people we can get onto it, the better it's going to work because we'll be able to make those connections and bring that business here.
So the Connects, this is Connects South Carolina. I would assume there is a Connects North Carolina, Connects so forth and so on. Is that the way this is working?
Right. So as the MEP centers adopt the platform and working with Connects Marketplace, they then administer it through their state MEP center.
Let's talk about supply chain mapping.
Okay.
Tell me about that. Tell me what it means. This is something that, again, I've been hearing a whole lot about recently, but just set it up for me.
Yeah, supply chain mapping is kind of new to me too. And I think the more that we are able to lean on data and use technology to help us see the ecosystem, we can make better choices. And that's really the goal of having a supply chain map. So what we've developed with our partners is basically a geographic map of South Carolina. And we're able to toggle between different industries, between different OEMs. We can see who's working for BMW, who's working for Mercedes, for Volvo, for Boeing, for Lockheed Martin. We're able to identify every supplier in the supply chain, notate whether it's a tier one, tier two, tier three, what revenue do they have coming into their company, how many employees do they have, and most importantly, what product or service are they providing back downstream to that OEM.
Miranda, before we go, I'll get you out of here on this. Let's head back to Connects for a second. How can manufacturers access that? What do they need to do?
Yeah, so a couple ways to get involved. They can visit our website. That's scmep.org. We've got a Connects webpage there. Everything is right there on that landing page, the login to Connects SC. Again, you register to the platform. Your registration comes to our team at SCMEP. We review that registration before we grant access. So there is some turnaround time involved with that. But if anybody has any questions, they can, of course, reach out to me. They can email me. They can connect with me on LinkedIn. I'm always happy to help manufacturers however I can.
Folks, that is Miranda Craig. She is the Business Development Associate at SCMEP. Miranda, thanks so much for joining us.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
It is good to have you here. Now, like I always say, folks, and I said at the beginning of this segment, SCMEP is a real value to the manufacturers in South Carolina. And basically, as I always say, if a manufacturer needs assistance in some way, SCMEP is there to help. So give those folks a call. Make sure you lean on them because that is what they are here for. And we're going to take a quick 60-second break, and we will be back with our next guest. Don't go anywhere.
Thank you for tuning in for another episode of Let's Talk Business, a weekly one-of-a-kind B2B talk show with interviews with South Carolina business executives, community leaders, and government dignitaries. Let's Talk Business airs every Saturday at 4 p.m. on 94.5 The Answer, or download it on the most popular platforms, Apple, Google, and Spotify. You can watch the video of each episode on YouTube. Search Let's Talk Business South Carolina. Now let's get back to the show with your host, longtime South Carolina business publisher Rick Jenkins.
Hello, everyone, and welcome back to Let's Talk Business, episode number 9. And now it is time for our featured guest. I'm glad that you are here with us. Whether you are joining us on 94.5 The Answer here in the Upstate, or maybe you're catching our podcast, or you are watching our YouTube series that comes out every week, regardless of how you're accessing, I appreciate you being here. And Pam Evett is with us, Lieutenant Governor. She's been with me a couple times before. I always enjoy having her here. Lieutenant Governor, welcome.
Thank you. Thanks for having me again.
It is good to have you. I want to talk about all kinds of fun stuff today.
Perfect.
Now, I want to start with manufacturing. Every time we're together, we always talk manufacturing, right? We know a little bit about manufacturing in South Carolina.
We lead in the globe.
We lead the globe, literally, in some situations. And let's talk about that. I mean, we are the number one exporter of tires in the world. We're the tire capital of the world.
Yep.
We are the number one exporter of ready-made vehicles, at least in terms of value, of export value, in the country. But there is something that some folks may not know, and that is we're pretty good in aerospace, too.
Oh, yeah.
As a matter of fact, let me make sure I have this right. South Carolina ranks number 3 nationwide in export value of aircraft and parts. Number 3. This kind of snuck up on us. Okay, so we had Boeing, you know, that pops in, what, in 09? And then now we manufacture something called an F-16 Fighting Falcon. All that's really cool, but this took me by surprise. Number 3.
Yes, we are. And, you know, so my good friend, Lieutenant Governor of Alabama, you know, Alabama is hanging on to that title. You know, they do a lot in aerospace, and every time we're together.
Are they number 1?
I think they are number 1.
Okay.
But
right.
I tell them they're only number 1 because we haven't really been trying, but I'm going to take that away from him very soon.
That's right. Once we decide to get serious about it.
That's right. Once it becomes in front of us, we're going to take it. And so, but we are, you know, thank goodness, Lockheed Martin, what an amazing partner to the state. Rolling the first F-16 Block 70s off.
Right.
We sold those. Had the generals from Bahram here. And I think when we talk about advanced manufacturing, we talk about manufacturing. We have to talk about our amazing technical colleges. Because, you know, a few years when Lockheed was looking at Greenville to start building those planes, they were looking for a workforce. And we sat down with them and said, it's our technical colleges. That's who will build you the workforce you need. And, you know, then fast forward, the first F-16s coming off the line. That was the first thing the president of Lockheed said, is you promised us that, you delivered that. And he said what touched him the most was seeing those 18, 19, 20-year-olds on that line, basically in tears with pride of what they were producing. And, you know, I talk about South Carolina's fingerprints all the time, and that is one of our fingerprints. Our fingerprints are on those planes, keeping our allies safe all over the globe.
Yeah. 400 aerospace companies in South Carolina, 136,000 jobs that are tied to aerospace. And much like we saw with the auto industry when BMW moved here, you know, way back in the early 90s, the supply chain follows.
Yeah.
And so now we have all of these companies that are in support of Boeing and in support of Lockheed Martin that continue to push this. Where do we go from here with aerospace? What do you think we're going to see?
I think we're going to see more production being done here. We're going to keep pushing out a good quality workforce. Again, compliments of our amazing technical colleges. But you touched on something that I don't think we talk about a lot. And I've been talking about it more and more. You know, when BMW came here, all the rigmarole that went around, you know, so much is going into BMW, there's incentives going to BMW, why is that happening? They're this big company that produces luxury cars. Now look today, if you had that globe back then, right, to the naysayers who didn't want BMW, and they didn't want the state to get involved in that transaction, can you imagine where we would be? Look at how many tier two, I just came back from BMW's Supplier Diversity Conference. And when you look at what they've done to South Carolina, they put us on a new trajectory. It was the tier two, the tier three, the mom and pop businesses, how they generated a whole economy. And look at all the entrepreneurs that would have never been able to jump into these spaces had BMW not come and settled here. So I want people to always think about that when they look at what's down the road. And, you know, we're competing with other states. So as a state, when we have to put incentives on the table, we're doing that because every other state is doing it. We just want to make sure that they're good, sound incentives that doesn't put taxpayer money at risk. And we have done a great job doing that here in South Carolina.
Electric vehicles. 17% of people have owned an electric vehicle. Now, this is nationwide, not South Carolina. 50% say they are likely to buy one in the next 5 years. U.S. average is 8.7 a thousand, but South Carolina is near the bottom at 3.1 a thousand in terms of per capita ownership of EVs. Mm-hmm. Do we care?
I think people care. I think what we need to care about as leaders, right, in the state is we want to make sure we're going where the market is driving us. No pun intended. We want to go where the market is driving us,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
And if EV is going to become something that is going to be a global thing where people are going to want this technology and they're going to use it, then we want to make sure that we're taking the lead on that here in South Carolina, if that's where everybody's going to. What I always want to say, because I get asked this question a lot, is in South Carolina, you're never going to see the governor or myself tell any South Carolinian what they should drive. You should drive what you want to drive, but if the technology is something that's going to be, you know, the wave of the future, well, we want to be in on that. And we want to make sure that those good quality, high paying jobs are right here in our state.
Federal government put out a target not too long ago, Biden administration, saying that half of new passenger cars and light trucks sold should be EV by the year 2030. Now, let's say, what is that? Let's provide some context. That moves the country from less than 3 million vehicles today to 50 million electric vehicles on the road in 7 years. Now, what would that mean? We would need another 1.2 million fast charging stations and another 28 million charging stations in your home. That is not possible, right?
Well, what I would say about the Biden administration is they haven't been too great with what they've been trying to do up until this point. I know I'm a little biased, but we saw what happened when you try to force anything, right? As Americans, we don't like government to force anything on us. California, their governor, came out saying that, you know, he wants all gas-powered vehicles off the road. And the very next day was begging people to turn down their energy, you know, turn off your air conditioners. We need the energy. We're going to have blackouts. But you've touched upon something that's very near and dear with the governor and myself and our administration is making sure that we are looking forward at what energy looks like here in our state. Many people are surprised to learn that on Christmas Day, we almost had a rolling blackout here in our state. There's lots of people that are really focused, the governor, one of them, on how are we going to make sure we have enough energy for not only South Carolinians, but for businesses that are coming here. It's crucial. So much so that he had an energy summit. I will be proud to be in Utah in another month, actually, at an energy summit out there, working hand in hand with Duke and Dominion to see what that looks like. Learning a lot about why, you know, solar is a great thing. But when the sun goes down, so does solar. I was out at Dominion looking at their control room, and you can see, you know, solar's coming in hot. No pun intended on that either, right? But when the sun goes down, solar drops off. So it has to couple with something that's reliable. And so
what is that?
Natural gas. And I don't think we should limit it to that, right? I think we need to look at everything to make sure that we're not limiting ourselves. But natural gas is huge. We have abundance of it here. The Biden administration did Americans no good service by shutting down pipelines. It made us energy dependent. I was in Israel a year ago where they were touting energy independence and how that gave them, such pride that they were. And I remember telling one of the Biden appointees, if he could please roll that up and let his boss know that my constituents would like to be energy independent again, too, and see what he could do about that. But it's true. We have to make sure that we're looking at all things. We're looking at nuclear, you know, the small modular nuclear reactors we need to be looking at. We need to be looking at natural gas. We need to be looking at everything. We need to look at solar. Solar is great. Solar has been part of our energy calculation for a long time here in South Carolina. But we have to make sure, again, that we couple it with something that's reliable, that we can spur up when we have a cloudy day here in South Carolina and we're not seeing the production out of solar. Duke Energy with its hydro power station here in the upstate, I'll be out there looking at that, really getting a grasp of what we need.
I want to steer you back to electric vehicles for a second. And I'm going back to this. I want to get your comment on what you think BMW, Volvo, Daimler, Daimler vans, Mercedes, which of course we have all in the state, might think about this. This is, whether we like it or not, it's a red state, blue state issue that we're dealing with here. The top 15 states that use electric vehicles are blue states, other than a couple, one of which being Arizona, which we're not sure what Arizona is these days, blue or red, right? And the bottom 15 states that don't use electric vehicles are, for the most part, red states. South Carolina, we're as red as red is red, right?
Absolutely.
No doubt about that. And I think under normal circumstances that we might just not care too much about this particular issue. However, we have BMW here, and BMW cares.
With a $1.7 billion investment last year.
That is correct. We have Volvo here. Volvo cares. We have Daimler vans, Mercedes. They're not producing electric vans right now down there, but they care. So from your perspective, how do you walk that line between what appears to me to be a state full of folks that don't really care? I mean, statistics back that up. However, what is running our economy in South Carolina, advanced manufacturing and automobiles, they do care. How do you walk that line?
Well, I think just like I said earlier, we want to make sure we're on the cutting edge of, you know, technology, wherever that is. And if the world is driving that market, then we should be producing it. But we don't have to drag our people along with us. That's the difference, really, between a red state and a blue state. Blue states shoving these things down people's throats. Here, we want people to feel comfortable with whatever they want to use, right? If they want to use their gas car, that's great. If you want to use an electric car, that's great. We really believe government should be out of people's business. Let people make informed choices. And when you do that, you'll bring people along if it's the right thing for them.
Let's change the subject and talk about IT, information technology. A story came across my desk here not too long ago that surprised me, much like the aerospace statistics that I was looking at. And this really surprised me. Charleston, and they count Myrtle Beach in there, is the fastest growing mid-sized metro area for IT jobs. And that includes cybersecurity and defense and consumer security. I did not expect that. How long has that been happening?
Well, it has. It's been creeping up. You know, PCmatic, you probably see them. They do a lot of advertising. PCmatic is based out of Myrtle Beach. You have DC Block coming into Myrtle Beach. What an amazing opportunity. My good friend, Dr. Ford, at Ori Georgetown Tech, they started a cyber program 5 years ago looking at how do we use cybersecurity and how do we help businesses, because we want South Carolina to have a diverse revenue stream, right? So I have kids, you have kids, everybody listening out there, a lot of them have kids. We want to make sure that as we get kids through our institutions of higher learning, whether it be our amazing technical colleges or our wonderful four universities, that we're able to keep those kids here and employed. So we want to make sure we have a diverse, a diverse landscape for them to stay here, whether it be IT, whether it be research, whether it be, you know, advanced manufacturing, whether it be aerospace. We are doing a good service by our people by making sure that we have a landscape of things. I mean, you add on to that, you know, tourism and agriculture, which I always say, you know, Dwayne Parrish and Hugh Weathers, they arm wrestle for number one, right, at any given point in the year. We don't talk about all that, but you encompass all that together. And then you look at this beautiful place we get to live in. You could have breakfast in the mountains and dinner at the coast in any given day. There's very few places you can say that. Our quality of life is amazing. We're able to, you know, afford our homes, something you don't see, you know, in places like California, New York, and New Jersey. People are getting fed up with that. You know, people need to be able to feed their kids and put a roof over their head. And that's why they're coming to states like ours.
High-tech jobs in Charleston have grown by 24% over the last few years compared to less than 9% nationwide. We've added 4,000 jobs. Now, I'm not sure, why do you think it's Charleston, the Low Country, that has been the center for the IT growth? Is it because of younger people because Charleston has been growing with young adults a lot quicker than the rest of the state? Is that part of it or what? What do you think?
Well, I think Charleston's a beautiful place to live. It's gotten a lot of national recognition long before other parts of the state did. It was kind of the first one to jump out. Remember wedding venues? That seemed That's right. to be the place where everybody wanted to go. So I think focus came on Charleston. People got down there. But we see that here in Greenville, too. You know, when we would have clients, David and I would have clients come in to our offices or do business with us, and they would stay in Greenville, and the first thing they'd say is, oh my gosh, I didn't realize how beautiful your city was. Like, I need to bring my family back. And so you're starting to see that, you know, Myrtle Beach has always gotten people's attention, because if you're from the north, this is halfway to Florida. People liked it. It's very family friendly. I think, you know, it could have been that. I think DC Block coming in is, like I said, a really big deal, putting in that, you know, underground fiber optics and doing data storage and management and security there. So you're just starting to see people want a good quality way of life. COVID, how many people came down here during COVID? Because, you know, we didn't lock down. People came down here because they got locked out of their states and then decided to stay. So I think you're seeing a lot of that. People thought, if I have to be locked up, I'm going to come down to South Carolina. I'm going to rent a house by the coast, right? I'm going to look out at that ocean. And then they said, dear Lord, I'm never leaving.
That's similar to what happened to me 2 decades ago. When we talk about South Carolina, we know from an industry perspective what drives it, or at least we think we do. We think of advanced manufacturing. Yep. We think of tourism, of course. Yep. But one thing that we don't always think, and it's really the biggest one in some regards, and that's agribusiness.
Yes.
It's not the biggest in terms of the total economic impact, even though it is second. But what I want to talk about is, let me back up. Let me give a little context to that. Agribusiness, 262,000 jobs in South Carolina, $52 billion in economic impact. That is slightly above aerospace. It is... of course, not where auto manufacturing is by any means. 5 million acres of farmland in South Carolina. The reason I bring this up is because the Department of Agriculture recently announced a new incentive program for agribusiness in the state. It's called the Growing Agribusiness Fund, and it will receive $40 million to help existing South Carolina businesses with processing, packaging, manufacturing, distribution, storage, blah, 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 all for our agribusiness industry. Yeah. Big stuff.
It is great stuff. You know, right here in the upstate, we have Brown's Meatpacking. Brown's used to actually, Hugh had told me the story, they used to send their meat up to New York to be processed, to come back down. And so this helps our businesses that are here bring more of the process here, keeping those jobs and dollars right here in our state. Titan Farms, I was out there about a month ago, you know, learning all about peaches. Our neighbors to the south, pretending to be the peach state. We are number three in the country for peach production.
I did not know that.
Triple. So, what happens?
So Georgia is number one, I'm assuming.
No.
Who's number?
We beat. I think it's California.
Really?
I think we're two. I'm sorry. I think we're two. We produce three times more peaches than Georgia.
No way. The peach tree state.
Yeah. I'm poking at their lieutenant governor all the time, saying that's fake news. That's fake news in South Carolina.
I love it. I did not know that. Okay, please keep going.
So we are doing a lot, and we have to make sure we help protect our farmers. And we have to make sure that bad policies, you know, I was out in Iowa last week with my, you know, other lieutenant governors from around the country, and being in Iowa, you know, that's the corn state, and, you know, that is the pork state. If you love bacon and sausage with your morning breakfast, that's where you want to be. Yeah. And hearing those farmers and their association talk about bad policy. So there's a piece of bad legislation coming out of California that would limit how many pigs could be together in one area, which would mean that hog farmers would have to have less livestock, which could, if it passes, could end up tripling the price of pork across the country. You see how bad legislative decisions could affect all of America, even though this is a state-driven initiative. Because what it would basically do would be stopping farmers from, if they didn't follow these guidelines, from selling to anybody in the state of California. And apparently, I want to say, I don't have my notes in front of me, it was about 18% of pork usage comes out of California. So it's a big deal for them. If they stood by it now, I would hope that they would just say, well, California, in your legislative team, we won't sell to you. And I bet I could get a bunch of people here in South Carolina to buy an extra pack of bacon or an extra pack of sausage every week. To, I think nationwide, we could get 49 states to eat up that 18%, I would hope.
I would guess so.
I would think so. I don't know about you, but my family would be very sad if bacon prices tripled.
Let's move to the other industry that drives the state, and that's tourism. Last year, we had a heck of a year. Matter of fact, we set state records. I don't remember what it was, but it was something like $28 billion of impact in the tourism industry in 2022. And I really thought we'd come back to the ground this year, but it appears that we're in the process of doing about the same this year that we did last year, which was set a record. We all love South Carolina, but what is happening?
Well, the secret's out. That's what it is. The secret's out about South Carolina. And, you know, we have so many great things to offer. People are coming to our state. You know, PGA, we're adding another PGA tournament to Myrtle Beach. Yes. We're bringing that back. That's going to be huge. So we're just, you know, wonderful to PRT. Dwayne is doing a great job. Dwayne Pierce, the director there, making sure he continues to bring in these great events that puts a spotlight really on our state and all the wonderful things it has to offer. I mean, golf courses per capita, can you beat South Carolina? Play on any ocean course and you'll probably never want to play anywhere else. So, you know, doing a great job of highlighting our strengths in that. And we, like I said, go back to the fact that South Carolina is a very affordable state. You can come here, our room prices are good. We have amazing restaurants, great food. So what's not to like?
Lieutenant Governor, I'm going to get you out of here on this. In May, the legislative session ended. Yes. Lots of stuff happened. Yes. A few months ago, you've had time to kind of process that. Give us some highlights. What were a couple of big things that came out of the session?
One thing that I'm very proud of, and I think because it, as a mom, it really pulled my heartstrings. I had some moms into my office November of last year talking about this fentanyl epidemic. They all lost children. Two of the three kids were thinking they were buying Adderall to stay awake at college. They were not drug users. This is a poison. One of the parents directly asked me, he said, when you talk about fentanyl, say it what it is. It's a poison. And we all know our kids, they do silly things, things that we ask them never to do because they don't think that it's ever going to be something that hurts them. But like in those two moms who sat crying in my office and said, help us. And I said, how do I help? And they said, we need laws. We need a law because fentanyl being a kind of a byproduct didn't have a law that our amazing law enforcement could lock people up for selling or distributing. And we did that this year. The General Assembly, thanks to them, Chief Keel played a huge role in that. Governor signed that into law. We will now have a stronger fentanyl law than the federal law that's on the books. If you are caught distributing, selling, producing fentanyl, you will go to jail up to 40 years. So I think it sent a very clear message to bad actors. If you're going to do this, don't do it in our state. But to be clear, the sentiment that comes from everybody is that if the Biden administration does not close our southern borders, this problem is going to continue to grow. And it is taking the lives of our children by leaps and bounds. It's the number one killer of children. And that should be something that opens up all of our eyes. But we can do all we can do in our state. But unless that southern border gets closed, we know it's the pathway. Chief Keel will tell you it's the pathway. Law enforcement will tell you they are. And our troops. Governor sent our troops to the border, our SC guard troops there. And the stories coming back is they didn't want to come back home. Not because they didn't miss their families, because they did, but they felt they had such a purpose down there. And they were catching the inflow of fentanyl left and right. And so to everybody that doesn't think the next election is going to be groundbreaking, it is. And if we look nothing else at the vulnerability of our country now, because we have an administration that will not close that border, just talk to a parent that lost a child to senseless things like this, and you'll know how important this issue is.
Good stuff. Lieutenant Governor, I appreciate you.
Thank you. I love coming on and talking. Yeah.
I appreciate
talking business
being
all
here.
The time.
Heck yeah, let's talk business more often. Folks, that is our Lieutenant Governor, South Carolina Lieutenant Governor Pamela Evatt.